Girlfriends. I love my girlfriend. You probably love your girlfriend. We all love our girlfriends. Though they might not be able to express their feelings very well, or they'll say that they aren't hungry but then proceed to eat your fries, we still love them to pieces because, let's be honest, they're putting up with your bullshit. And in video games, the same logic applies. Video game GFs might be dead, alive, gay, straight, funny, boring, it doesn't matter because just like real life, video game girlfriends come in all lovable shapes and sizes. And today, we will be appreciating these women that have stuck with us through trial and tribulation as we melt our goblin brains in their respective worlds. But before we get into that, let's take a quick history lesson. In classic games, women were typically seen as the damsel in distress, often only being distinguishable from the male sprites due to their more feminine features, such as long eyelashes, long hair, and makeup. This can be seen with the better version of Pac-Man, that being Miss Pac-Man, and Pauline from 1981's Donkey Kong. Even though Miss Pac-Man might be the first playable female in a video game, the true win for women was when in 1986's Metroid released. For those who may not know, Metroid, the first Metroid, it was originally released for the Famicom Disk System in August 6, 1986, and later for the Nintendo Entertainment System in August 1987. The game was produced by one of Nintendo's most prolific game and hardware designers, Gunpei Yokoi, and directed by Yoshio Sakamoto. Metroid provided the first highly non-linear game experience on home console, the basic gameplay setup being a mix of action, adventure, and platform shooter. However, unbeknownst to many who may have picked up on the game at the time is that the main character, Samus, is actually revealed to be a really hot blonde in the end.
Oh my god!
Feminism, am I right? Soon after, we would see a decent number of female protagonists populate a variety of different games, games you most likely have never heard of, but men primarily took the role of protagonists in most video games, with women often being presented as over-sexualized objects that either needed to be saved or pushed to the sidelines. Now, there isn't anything wrong with women being all sexy-like, but it's unfortunate to see the big brolic man with the shiny muscles take center stage during this time. However, I would argue this actually had a pretty positive effect for women in the long term. Think about it. For every 100th white male protagonist, we had an iconic female character like Chun-Li, Lara Croft, Jill Valentine, Samus, Tara Branford, and many, many more. I would argue the fourth generation of video games began the uphill climb for female representation in video games, often bringing these women center stage and defying many of the norms we'd previously seen. Take for example Rosa and Rydia in Final Fantasy IV. These characters often defy their male party members and fight alongside them even until the very end, offering permanent depth to female representation within video games. But enough of the history lesson, let's get back into our favorite gaming girls. As stated before, the girl in the video game might be the sole reason as to why the protagonist is doing what they're doing. Games like Shadow of the Colossus and Legend of Zelda 2 see the protagonist journeying to revive their deceased beloved, either by killing 16 gentle giants or exploring various dungeons and talking to whatever the hell these people are. And for those who want to correct by saying Zelda is under a sleeping spell, kindly just backflip from the keyboard because obviously Nintendo didn't want to say that she was dead. In other games, there are plot points where the protagonist's girlfriends are in need of saving, or the protagonist might be on a murdering rampage because the girlfriend, or wife in this case, wasn't saved. Characters like Raz from Psychonauts, Dante from Devil May Cry, Kratos from God of War, Wander from Shadow of the Colossus, and Link from The Legend of Zelda all serve as protagonists with their love interest in mind. Girlfriends being the main motivation for the story can offer rewarding ends, often with satisfying closure, or maybe even a kiss, or maybe she becomes your mom, I don't know. Other examples of the female race being the main motivation in games can be seen within games like Catherine. Whereas in Catherine, you play as a dude named Vincent, who is beset by supernatural nightmares while being torn between his feelings for his longtime girlfriend, Catherine with a K, and the similarly named Catherine with a C, both being total babes in their own right. Dating sim games like Doki Doki Literature Club and Honey Pop are a genre built upon the sole motivation of befriending females and dating them, but minus Doki Doki, these games are built for heathens, so I'm gonna leave them alone. Other games I can list where the character journeys for female attention are Silent Hill 2, Mario, Sonic, Halo 3, and the Crash Bandicoot games, and the list goes on and on and on. I think you get the point. A good number of games feature the protagonist's girlfriend starring alongside them, and aren't necessarily the sole focus of the game's plot. Games like Uncharted, Halo, Resident Evil, and Castlevania all feature female characters that journey alongside the protagonist, sometimes with explicit love interest and other times it's a little bit more discreet. Uncharted features two love interests for Nathan Drake, one Elena Fisher and two Chloe Frazier, a good and a bad girl for Drake to settle down with. Cortana in the Halo series has a direct attachment to Master Chief, and though it may be platonic, it is very clear that these characters care deeply about each other. And in Resident Evil, the OG fuckboy Leon has a litany of potential romantic partners, that being Claire, Ada, Hunnigan, and Ashley. And lastly, in Castlevania 3, Trevor and Sifa get together, leaving Alucard in the dust, quite literally because he's like a million years old and they're dead by the events of Symphony of the Night. Now, RPGs often have really in-depth dating mechanics, in which there are many dating sims within the game. Let's tackle these one by one. In Final Fantasy VII, Cloud is often seen being torn between Aerith or Tifa, Aerith being the cute alien chick with the sweet personality and Tifa being the objectively better choice. Also in Final Fantasy VII, there is a hidden affinity system that is in effect whenever dialogue is beset to the player, thus scoring affinity points to whoever likes your response the best. Hell, you aren't even restricted to Aerith or Tifa in-game either. Characters like Yuffie and even Barrett, the best girl, can be taken on the date to the Golden Saucer as well. In the Persona games, there is a social link system, where when you hit a certain social link with a character, you get an opportunity to ask them out. The beauty of the system is that it's entirely optional and it's very open-ended. Seriously, there are a lot of romantic partners you can get involved with within the Persona franchise. Lastly, in BioWare games, you also get the option to romance your party members, often by you just either being nice or talking to them any chance you can get. In fact, the dating in Mass Effect is pretty sophisticated, as not only do your love interests carry over into the second and the third game, but you can also get them killed, cheat on them, break up with them, get back together, and see them get romantically involved with other crew members of the Normandy. The final entry into the video is the section where you are the girlfriend, rather than vice versa. There's some overlap in this section with some games that I've previously mentioned before, like for example in Mass Effect, where you have the option to play as FemShep and romance both the male and female crew members of your party. The Scott Pilgrim video game features in all three of these categories, as not only is your motivation to defeat Ramona's seven evil exes, but you can also play alongside Ramona as well as play as her yourself. And you can also play as Scott's other love interests, that being Knives and Kim. In The First Last of Us, Ellie's sexuality was revealed with the Left Behind DLC, showing that she actually had a thing for girls this entire time, even though it was kind of pretty obvious. In Part 2, not only do you get to play as Ellie, you venture into Seattle with your gorgeous new girlfriend, but you also get to play as Abby, who is kind of Owen's love interest in the game, but boo Owen. In Final Fantasy X-2, you get to play as the last protagonist's love interest, that being Yuna, featuring alongside other two female party members, Riku and Pain. And in the Uncharted spin-off, Lost Legacy, you get to play as Chloe from Uncharted 2 and 3, the femme fatale that rocked my childhood. Now, what's awesome about these games is that you aren't on a quest to save your significant other. What the writers tend to do when featuring female protagonists is to have the main story center around an evil force, or just surviving, with little to no romantic involvement with anyone. I find this interesting in contrast to male protagonists who seem to do almost anything for women. I guess men only want one thing. But we'll save that for another time. Instead, I'll leave you with this. If games have taught us anything about our girlfriends, it's that we really need to love and appreciate them. It doesn't take much to go on adventures with your girl, even if it's just to your local Fleet Farm. Shout out to the Midwest. Video games have taught us to go above and beyond when it comes to dating. Talk to them every chance you can get. Go on dangerous quests for fame or fortune. Revive them from the dead, even if it has drastic consequences for your mortal well-being, and carry on their wishes from the grave, because you know what? Women are awesome. Plain and simple.